more gangs. There's no more drummy. Okay? It's out.
You're going to be able to protect yourself. We give it up right now. We'll be dead within 2 weeks.
We don't belong to any gang, we belong to a gang.
I don't see it, man. If you're running about a gang, you get chipped. And that's your hard line, isn't it? You shouldn't have grass, you shouldn't have tell the screws.
Members of the Shamrock gang gather in the centre of Glasgow. Despite Frankie Vaughan's efforts on one estate, the Glasgow gangs still exist. In a city of over 1 million good people, there is still a minority prepared to resort to explosive violence for kicks. How did Joe Devlin, not yet 17, become leader of the Shamrock?
I've done my time inside. Everybody just, you know, take me for a little man, you know, because I do things people don't do, you know. Like I say, I'm always at the front of the crowd if there's a fight, you know? I'm always right in the front if there's any damage. Because nearly everybody wants to get the front, you know, but I always see me end up in the front, you know, when there's a fight.
You fight with your fists?
No, we'll use hatches and that. You know, other kind of weapons, anything at all, you know?
You might kill somebody.
Oh, you don't think you're going to kill them. I mean, like I say, if sixies plunge them at the same time, it's a good chance, you know, but you don't think you're going to kill them till maybe after that. It might be seriously ill or something like that, you know, but you don't think you're going to do them in. But it's happened a couple of times. Like I said, the boys killed that bloke in the fleet, did them in. Some of the boys did a bit of grass and 4 of them stayed in time. We don't like that at all. That's how we were doing that time to see the score, you know.
How did you feel when you heard that heard that somebody had actually died there in a fight?
I get a good night's sleep after that. I don't bother.
You'd not have been too worried if you had done him in, would you?
I would have been worried, you know, but you don't think you're going to do him in, you know? I mean, like I say, the bloke's lying there screaming. As long as he still screams, it's okay, you know? He doesn't scream. It's just phone for the ambulance right away.
Saturday night in Glasgow is busy night for the hospitals. Victims of casual violence queue for treatment alongside the 20th century's more orthodox casualties. In 1967, there were 1,465 reported crimes of violence in Glasgow. But the real figure is likely to be greater. The doctors have to take their patients' word for the cause of their wounds. It is often wiser not to talk. This boy said he fell on a bottle. Perhaps he did. Drink is often the fuel of violence, and alcoholism is 5 times more common in Scotland than England. It is not the only cause. The gangs will fight cold sober while the drunks sit it out. Saturday night in the Locarno dance hall, and Glasgow belongs to its youth. Burly men watch warily for the known troublemakers. Glasgow sprawls over 62 square miles, but the entertainment spots are crammed into a few streets in the city centre. On Saturday, all roads lead to Sockey Hall Street. For most, the Locarno is a place for an evening's innocent enjoyment. For a few, it is a disputed no-man's land. Everything is planned to nip trouble in the bud. The front door is heavily guarded, and each male must submit to a frisking. Some are known to the doorman and are asked firmly to go elsewhere. But the weapons are not easy to find. Only the boys are frisked, and a sharpened steel comb slips easily into a handbag. The more experienced gang members take good care not to be caught in possession of an offensive weapon. Mr. James Cameron, Mecca's Scottish director, is satisfied his men do a good job.
Well, we have been doing this searching since the war, in actual fact. We're looking for alcohol in Glasgow. It's a very well-known thing that they have a carry-out. And they have lots of these teenagers have half bottles of something. If it's not vodka, it's whiskey or something like that, and we're looking for it. We take it off them, give them a ticket for it, and they retrieve it on the way out. That's exactly why. At the same time, no doubt you've heard about the violence in Glasgow, and it serves as a double purpose nowadays. Should they have any weapons with them, we are able to find same. But we're happy to say it's very seldom we do find any weapons.
How many staff, how many sort of straight bouncers do you have in there?
Well, they're known as supervisors, ballroom supervisors. This word bouncer is way outdated as far as we're concerned, but we have 12. And a very heavy front door staff, as you see, because we look upon it that the front door is to prevent them coming in altogether. But should anything unforeseen happen inside, we will stop it as soon as possible, as quickly as possible.
Some troublemakers succeed in slipping past Mr. Cameron's guard. Then the system moves into action to remove them as quickly and as speedily as possible. But there is no way of planning for the peculiar, unpredictable nature of teenage violence. To combat gang violence, the chief constable has formed a special squad of men known to the gangs as the Untouchables. The police, who say they are on top of the problem, never officially use the word gang fight.
Sergeant McMaster, you're one of what I understand in Glasgow referred to as an untouchable. What's the word mean?
The Untouchable series was devised from a television series which was particularly popular in Glasgow. The plainclothes officers in America were used to combat federal offences, and the local youth have used this as a nickname for the group disorder vehicles which operate in the city.
You say group disorder, a gang fight?
Group disorder is a better word, I would say.
Sergeant, what exactly do you do?
Well, prior to 1966, there were numerous outbreaks of group disorders in the housing schemes of the city, and in January 1967, the chief constable formed in each division a group disorder vehicle composed of a sergeant and a number of constables. The object of this was to combat group disorder. Obviously, one constable or two constables on duty in the street coming across perhaps a number of youths engaged in group disorder were unable to combat this on their own, and these vehicles were brought in to being so that in the event of a call being received, they could be quickly dispatched to the scene and deal with the situation as they found it.
I've spoken, though, I mean, to young people here who say, or it's not gang warfare, but that they still sort of can't go off this scheme down into another scheme or down into other areas without the risk of running into trouble. Is this so?
I wouldn't say so. I think that's a ridiculous assumption on their part. That any person can walk freely in any street in Glasgow without danger of being molested in any way.
Oh, Sergeant, people have been stabbed in the streets of Glasgow.
People have been stabbed in the streets elsewhere too.
A black eye gained in a fair fight is flaunted like a battle honour. There is little doubt that the gangs exaggerate their own importance. But surely behind their somewhat grandiose claims to have divided the centre of Glasgow among themselves, there is a lonely need to belong. They lay claim to territory and fight to hold it.
Shamrock's got a good bit of territory down the town, you know, Dundas Street, Gale Street. You know, they've got a good bit. And I like to say, if any other team come in here, you know, like to say, we walk about these places, and if any other team comes in here, it's a fight right away. That's the way it goes.
What do you mean you've got this territory? I mean, this is an open street in the middle of a city.
Well, like to say, the Cumbie, you know Union Street in Glasgow? Cumbie run about there. That's their territory, you know. We can't go along here, although not unless maybe there's one or two, you know, because it's busy. They can't come along here. If they do come along, there's bound to be a team of them. That's a fight.
Do you keep the fights private among yourselves? I mean, I can walk down these streets.
No, don't think so. I mean, if you're standing there on a gang fair, you probably just get what anybody else is getting.
Ah, but if I just walk down it, I mean, I'm allowed to come down the street if I'm not with you or with one of the other gangs.
Well, like say, the Shamrock, that's one thing about them, you know, they don't take liberties, you know, but Cumbie, you know, they take, like say, if they're running down a street, fighting that, they just hit anybody.
Yummy, 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 we're the Crusade, Cumbie, and we feel like chubbing a tin.
The identification with the gang is sometimes total. The Cumbie gang claim the rapidly vanishing slumland of the Gorbals as their territory, but few live there. When I asked where they lived, they replied not with place names, but with the names of their nearest gang.
I live out beside the Shamrock.
I live beside the Fleet.
I live beside the Bundy.
I live beside the
Hull.
So most of you live north of the river?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, how you run with a gang on the south side?
Because of the best team
in here.
Because everybody used to come for here. For the Suicide, I say, you just keep going back down to Suicide.
And we're the best team in Glasgow.
It's like a regiment.
Oh,
it's not us. It is. It's like a clan.
Not Black Watch,
it's like
anyway.
A clan. I mean, you stand by them.
It's just mates you've got. You get more mates. You just be running about with one or two mates, you know.
Well, look at the birds we've got, they're brilliant. Oh, that's a dollar, yummy.
Two slaps.
Most people who come from the south look at the Gorbals and they say, hell with that place. I mean, that's really the worst place I've ever seen, and yet it means a lot to you.
Because,
why?
Because we originated from here, and we're going to stay here, no matter what comes up or what comes down.
You grow up here, don't you?
Well, what's it got that the new places haven't got?
Atmosphere. I mean, people are friendly down here now. I mean, the atmosphere in these schemes.
Faced with a housing problem of disaster proportions, the Glasgow Corporation have built over 80,000 homes since the war. It is a remarkable achievement. But they have been criticised for not providing sufficient shops and community facilities on the estates. The young say the estates are just a place to sleep, and in Black Hill, the few shops are steel shuttered against the violence which some say is born of boredom. Thanks to the efforts of Frankie Vaughan, the Easter House estate now looks as if it is going to get a youth centre. It remains to be seen if that will end the violence. But for the mothers on the estate, talking with their MP Hugh Brown, there is no doubt that Easter House lacks a community heart.
There's no community centre if you're amongst the people themselves. There's no spirit. We all come up here with good intentions. We came here thinking we're giving our children a better chance. We're moving out of the city itself, coming out to fresh air, open fields and all the rest of it, which was all we do have. And what has happened? Nothing's happened.
Well,
I mean,
the
shopping centre, we've promised libraries. We've now got a library open 2 weeks ago, and we've been 10 years here.
Uh-huh.
I mean,
really,
what else is there? I mean, when you come to think of it...
Hugh Brown, I've heard this from the kids, I've heard it from the mothers here. Now, why didn't you build these things in the first place?
Well, the library is a specific example of where we've been caught up, because there is a new library planned to be part of the major commercial centre.
Why didn't you do all these things to begin with? That's really the question, isn't it?
One of the reasons you didn't do it then was because the commercial interests weren't interested in coming in until the scheme had been fully completed. You can't force private enterprise to come in until they're ready to. We're talking in terms of £3 or £4 million of investment in here, and you won't get them to come in until.
Why not?
But I'm sorry, if I can interrupt you, Mr. Brown. I mean, when you build, when towns are built other places in the country, when they build the new towns, I mean, they build a community centre, they build swimming pools, they build libraries. At that time, why didn't you do it 10 years ago?
Well, no, I don't think this is true. I don't think this always happens in every new town, but it's quite true. The main reason for it was the demand for housing. Don't forget, we're talking in the post-war demands of people like this lady here. Quite rightly so, this was their first corporation house. Desperate to get a new house because they were overcrowded. So the emphasis was in housing. Build more housing and the community facilities will come along after. There's a two-way here thing here. I'm not excusing the mistakes and the failures and the delays and what we've been talking about. But as I say, there's also, if you like, in a democratic community, there's more need for us to talk oftener and try and understand why some of these difficulties have arisen, and also to encourage people to take more part in the running of their own affairs in local organisations. There should be more active adults in churches or in all sorts of voluntary bodies who should be coming along and saying, look, what can I do to help to make this better?
If they put one community centre in each section, I think it would help an awful lot. I think it really would help. The one at Well House, if our boys go down to Well House, there's a gang down there, he's already been down there. Our boys go down there, they get chased back up again. They're not allowed in. See? And I think if you really built a community centre in each section, as Mr Brown already knows that, if it was built in each section, I think it would help an awful lot. Because I have a boy at 15 too, and he would go to these centres, but he'll not go down to Well House.
Why won't he go down?
Because he's afraid to go down. I have a boy at 18 and he won't go near Well House.
He wouldn't be allowed in, anyway.
He wouldn't be allowed in, he'd get chased.
No. It's on a territorial basis and there just aren't enough of them.
Showbiz personality or social worker, somehow Frankie Vaughan manages to combine the two. No one can accuse him of doing good by stealth. Yet those who thought that he would quickly drop his interest in Glasgow have been confounded. He has been back and back again.
Cheese!
Somehow, Vaughan does appear to have established a bridgehead between the adult world of law and order and the youth. Yet his first venture could hardly have given him much cause for optimism. No one knew quite what to expect when the police agreed to Vaughan's proposal for an amnesty, during which gang weapons could be handed in. But most of Easterhouse, reinforced by a small army of pressmen and photographers, came along to watch the fun. At first it looked as if nothing at all was going to happen. Then the weapons, that is what they were, began to arrive. It looked as if someone had been raiding the backyard of a hardware store. Even by the standards of the gangs, much of what was handed in appeared to come within the category of obsolescent. In the midst of it all, the police maintained a passive neutrality. As a social experiment, the proceedings had an odd carnival air, and although he has since become a trustee of the Youth Centre project, Glasgow's police convener, Bailey Anderson, was unimpressed.
Well, of course, this is a comic opera and nothing more, nothing less.
Why do you say that?
Well, I say this quite simply because, speaking to some of the gang leaders this afternoon, they're just going along for the publicity, they're just taking people for a ride.
You believe that this is, if it's not done any good, do you believe it may have done harm?
Yes, I think it's done a great deal of harm because I think, quite frankly, that this has idolised the people who commit those crimes of violence, and those children see the gang leaders being idolised, being publicised. And, of course, I think those children will attempt to emulate those gang leaders who have attracted so much attention.
Mr Anderson, if this isn't the answer, what is the answer to Glasgow's gang problem?
Well, we have found the problem by deterrent sentences in the High Court. Well, they have been ranging in the past week between 8 and 12 years imprisonment for attacks by an offensive weapon. And I think this is the real and the true answer. We must just simply, it's at the stage when we have to frighten people into good behaviour.
But aren't there, in fact, also, deep social reasons for this?
No, well, I don't see the deep social reasons for this, because we have got hundreds of and thousands of good kids here in Easterhouse who live in the same housing conditions, who have the same educational opportunities, who have the same job prospects. They behave themselves. They are good citizens. So, you see, I cannot accept that.
Don't you accept what many sociologists and people like that say are the underlying causes of the gangs, the lack of a community spirit, the lack of a community life in the estates and things like that?
I don't accept this at all, not for one minute, because not all the gangs are centred in Easterhouse or in the vast housing estates. So let the sociologists explain why gangs should not be in other areas of the city where there is a similar problem.
Seems to me what you're saying, Bailey Anderson, is that the authority has no more answer to the gangs than simply to meet their violence with heavy sentences.
Yes, I think this is the real answer, because I quite simply believe that the greatest deterrent against a person committing a crime is the sure and certain knowledge that they will be caught, convicted and adequately punished. I know this is frightening people into good behaviour, but I am afraid that this is the only answer. And as police convener, this is the action that I'm taking, and which is meeting with quite a degree of success.
You're going to end up in Barlinnie if you go on like this, aren't you, Joe?
It's a good chance, yeah. Probably will come, you know. But, well, I mean, if it comes, it comes, you know. You don't fancy it, but you can't be helped, can you? You don't think you're getting a jail, but if you get a jail, that's it.
What does the gang mean to you, Joe? How important is it in your life?
It doesn't mean to us. It doesn't bother. You know, just that. There's nothing else to do, so... I mean, started running a bit for, you know, for a laugh, you know? Started running a bit with them, then... People get to know you. You get to know people now. And that's it. You just got to keep going. Keep on going with them. Because you kind of chuck it.
Yeah, when it's all said and done, Joe, you'd really like to get out of it, wouldn't you?
I'd like to go, but it's too late now. Maybe if I mean, I'm good, I'll try, you know, stay away, but try it a couple of times. It's hard, you know.
We offer the same kind of opportunities to these youngsters that we would offer to middle-class children. I think this is there's a very strong social class problem here. We have to give them good schooling, and I mean really good education. We have to give them social opportunities to be able to talk in a civilized way, to be able to behave in a civilized way. We have to offer them entertainment opportunities with constructive use of themselves in a variety of ways. We can't start this, I don't think, with the 17-year-old very easily. We're always doing a repair job on the 17-year-old. We've got to start with the 3-year-old in terms of preschool playgroups. We've got to have smaller classes in school. We've got to have play facilities outside the school. We've got to involve the mothers and fathers of the families, not in a negative, but in a positive way. Now, what I mean by that is that at the moment we tend to attack the parents for not being good parents. I think what they need is help in understanding the kind of activities the youngsters are engaging in. We've got to increase the opportunities for these young people to get jobs like apprentices and not just dull labouring jobs that aren't worthwhile doing.
By the time the social reforms that you talk about and the expenditure of money that is needed is taking place, a lot of these people are just going to be in jail, the 16, 17-year-olds, aren't they?
Yes, this is very sad. And perhaps we've got to make a decision to let this generation go. One of the things that worries me is that people are always moaning about these problems, but they're never prepared to take a cold look at what it's going to cost to mend them. And I would suggest that if we started really preventative levels of work, that we would find that this was helping a lot of problems other than the particular one they're worried about, gang violence.
We want Frankie Vaughan!
The children greet Frankie Vaughan as they would any pop singer. But the response of the teenagers has been more interesting and is of much greater importance.
The reason I came here today is I wanted to meet as many of the lads and girls as possible, right? There's no point in me going here with any plans unless you're all in on it and you've seen the
For the moment, he appears to have got through to them. In return for his promise to help raise money for a youth centre on the estate, the Easter House boys have agreed to give up their allegiance to the gangs. They've even scrubbed the slogans from the walls.
Things that you want to be involved with in the centre. For sport, there's badminton, tournament tennis, boxing ring, trampoline, nine table tennis. Table tennis.
No one knows how long the truce will last. And even if the experiment is a success, it will not mean that the problem of Glasgow's violent teenagers has been solved overnight. But a new start has been made.
And of course, you've got coffee areas and a place to dance, sort of discotheques.
But not all Glasgow's youth live in Easter House. For the Spur gang from the slums of Bridgeton, a trip to the hills is an escape. It is also a reminder that other social workers, less well-known and less equipped to raise money, live with the problem of a bored and potentially violent youth every day. John Webster is a Church of Scotland minister, but there is little deference in the gang's attitude to him. He can promise them very little other than his friendship and the hope that he may persuade others to care.
What are you really trying to do with these lads? What's it all about?
It's a good question. What are they trying to do with me? You saw this just a minute ago, didn't you? To be friends, if you want, the easiest angle. To try and show that someone cares in an impersonal, violent world. This sounds perhaps highfalutin. I think it's just a statement of fact. To show that someone cares. At school, fairly impersonal. Home life, fairly impersonal. Work, fairly impersonal. The street corner, the pub, the tote, the police, all impersonal. It has to be in many cases. Treat them as human beings. They'll respond.
Do you think that by doing this, though, you say they respond, do you in fact think that you can do anything to sort of lessen the violence of Glasgow?
I think so. I think if there was a lot of clubs like this, a big contribution could be made. We don't say we've the answer, but certainly the answer doesn't lie in pontificating from vacuums of inexperience. Letters to the papers. You know, get your MP, the councillors should do this, the police should do this. And the people who write these letters will not roll up their sleeves and get their hands in amongst it. If you know the boys as persons, then it seems there are redemptive possibilities.
What's a trip like this mean to them?
Well, I think you can see for yourselves. It's escape, you know? The police aren't here watching them. The local people aren't here. There's no one. They're just themselves. They can escape. They can be themselves. They can be rowdy. They won't be held for breach of the peace or anything like this. They're living here. Look, I mean, throwing stones around, cooking, putting a tent up, complete escape. They wouldn't like to live up here, mind you. They're much happier living cheek by jowl in their own community, with flooded back courts, with choked drains and this sort of thing. But here for a while they've escaped. The only way to do it is to get down amongst them. Bridgeton and other districts in Glasgow are leaderless communities because the professional people, they just bail out at night and the community reverts to type. There is no solution. We have no solution. But I think the nearest one can get to showing some kind of solution is to identify oneself, to care, to befriend, and you'll find that many of these boys, much maligned, are the salt of the earth.
Mr. Webster, you talk about this sort of professional exodus and the need perhaps for the letter writers and those who condemn to come in and help, but are there specific things that the government, that the Glasgow City Fathers can do?
I think do the same as your professional people might do. Provided there is a little money available, come in and befriend. People with cars can take six boys away for a weekend, skiing in the winter time, hill climbing in the summer, get to know just a small group. Let them see, I think, that the cars that flash through daily, you know, that the professional people in them care, that the bosses at the work care. The old days, it was an awful lot to be said for it when you had the community village built round the factory, when bosses and workers, in their spare time, played on the bowling green, played elsewhere together, were seen in the pubs together.
Do you think there's much likelihood of this happening in
Glasgow? Not a hope. And so you've no solution. The only solution is that somebody cares.